We're entering week three of our Epiphany sermon series over the good and beautiful God. I'm taking essentially an idea out of each of the chapters each week and going over that. And the main theme, I would say, of the overall series is to change our narrative, to change our immediate thought about who God is. We talked about narrative a little bit last week, and we did the exercise where we wrote down the first thought we had about God, and that's our overall narrative, our main thought about God. And to begin to change, we realize we have to change that narrative, change that thought first. In the next few weeks, we're going to look at major narratives that I would say are incorrect about God, that are wrong. In this group, we're looking at the idea that God is trustworthy. Because actually, a lot of people have come to the conclusion in our culture that God is not trustworthy. We'll get to why in a minute. And I was thinking about this, and this whole idea of trust, and what trust is. And it really hit me yesterday. As some of you know, I drove out to El Paso this weekend to help one of my friends out who's in the military. Car back to him that we've been holding the last few months since he transferred from Germany to beautiful, beautiful El Paso, Texas. And we drove out, or I drove out, and then flew back. And one of the big things about me is I'm terrified of flying. It's nothing like sitting 30,000 feet in the air and realizing there's only a few thin sheets of metal between you and lots and lots of free space until you hit the ground very suddenly. That's usually the thought process I have as I board the plane, as I step through the threshold and think, oh man, that's not that plane, it's not very thick. And this was an especially trying time. First, on this flight back, there was amazingly strong winds. The winds were about 30 to 35 miles an hour, and they were gusting up to 40, 45 miles an hour. You could just stand outside and feel the wind swishing on you. Or like me, sit beside the window of the terminal and watch the plane shake on the ground in the wind. The other great thing about this flight is on the way to the airport, we had a little bit of extra time, so we stopped outside an aviation museum. There's a rather large aviation museum out in right over the New Mexico border with El Paso. And it has a lot of old historic prototypes from late World War II, early Korean War that were donated by NASA, because NASA used to have a big facility out there. And I love my friends to death because they know how much I'm scared of flying, so they took me to this aviation museum and we ended on the section that's commemorating all the different crashes that had happened at this airport. Got a great picture of me and made me pose beside this propeller that was bent in 20 different directions. And below it, the flag says the only thing recovered from the crash. Flying is not my thing. It terrifies me. And it terrifies me because it's about trust. You get on the plane, and you sit down, and they seal the door to the cockpit, and you have to trust that the pilot knows what they are doing. And you have to trust that in any situation, the pilot will use their best judgment to maintain your safety. And you have to trust in that pilot to get you off the ground, through the air, and to the other point. Now I know all the facts about flying as if they would call me down. I know I could fly multiple times a day for the next 100 years and never once be in a commercial airline crash. I know that it's the safest form of transportation. I also know it takes a lot longer to drive from El Paso than to fly. And all these things I know, but it's that trust. It's that trust, that relationship you have to build with the pilot. And at the core, one of the reasons I'm so terrified about flying is because I don't really trust well enough. My trust is not strong enough with this stranger who's flying my plane. A great example was this flight we went on years ago, one of the first times I flew in the snow. And I've told a few of you this story personally. I was flying back from Kentucky, and it was snowing out. And we were the first flight of the day. We were taking off at 5:45 a.m. from Bluegrass Airport. And we taxi around, and it's that quiet calm you hear when it's snowing. That muffled calm. And the engines rev up, and we start to take off, and we get going down the runway. We're going really fast. The point where the plane starts to lift off the ground, and everything's shaking. And at that moment, the plane lost power. And all of the lights went out. Even the little light on the wings that blinked went dead. And the plane, in that still silence, rolled to a stop. And other than the gasping and the audible sobbing, there was not a single sound in that snowy morning. And then the emergency lights came up, and the pilot came on and said, "Well, folks, we've got a small electrical issue. We're going to taxi around and try again." That wasn't quite my response. See, you have to trust that pilot knows what they're doing, that they are going to have your best interest at heart. And naturally, that trust is not something that comes easy for people. And it's something that is quickly lost, but over a long time is so very hard to gain. So it's easy when you think of it in that term, in that frame, to understand why a lot of people don't think they can trust God. Part of it has to do with the fact that we treat God like a cosmic vending machine. If we insert prayers, and if we insert offerings, and if we insert enough church attendance, which all those things are good, don't quit doing it, please. But we think if we insert enough of those things, and when we pray, we'll get what we want. And most of the times, we even pray in a selfish attitude. Almost all of our prayers are asking about something for us. And then when God doesn't work like a cosmic vending machine, He doesn't just spit out what we want because we put prayer in, then we get hurt and we get confused and we don't feel like we can trust Him for a reliable outcome. We become kind of like I was sitting on that snowy runway years ago. I fully expected as the plane lurched down the tarmac to have it take off and us to be sailing in the sky. And when that didn't happen, that trust between myself and the pilot was damaged. And I felt like, oh, I don't know if this guy really cares enough about me. I don't know. I mean, shoot, all the lights went out. He's going to try it again with the plane? Does he really know what he's doing? Is someone not up there trying to stop him? See, those are things that I was thinking. There are also things that we think when we lose our trust of God. We see bad things happen and we instantly think, is someone up there really paying attention to the situation on the ground? Is someone up there, do they really know what to do? Is someone up there actively helping? We lose that trust. And we lose it because our expectations weren't met. Because our expectations in the end weren't real. There's a Jim Carrey movie back in the late 90s, early 2000s called Bruce Almighty. And Jim Carrey's character, Bruce, wanted to be God and through the divine providence of Morgan Freeman, he became God for a little while. And there's a point where he's answering prayers, and it's a big stick on Yahoo email accounts and blah, blah, blah. But he just answers everyone's prayer to win the lottery. everyone just wins the lottery. He goes around answering prayers like that. And the world erupts in chaos. Also, the lottery winning was like $5 because everyone won it. But the world erupted in chaos because people just asked, and whatever they asked for, they got. Oh, I'd love a new higher paying job. Oof, they got it. I would like this. Oof, they got it. Oof, they got it. Like that cosmic vending machine. They just asked, and they got it. They received whatever their heart's desire was. And strangely enough, that caused the world to break down. Because they only focused on themselves. In building a relationship of trust with God, we have to let go of this foolish notion that God is simply there to grant us what we want. Instead, God is there to see that we have what we need. That is the God that Jesus reveals. That's the narrative of God that we have to build our trust in God around. Is the idea that God isn't here to provide us every single desire of our heart, but God is here to provide us exactly what we need when He sees that we need it. And we see that in Jesus' prayer. If you back up a little bit, this is a small section of a larger part of Matthew called the Sermon on the Mount. Kind of a summary of Jesus' thoughts and ministries. And Jesus teaches the people to pray. The Gentiles and the priests are very vain in their prayers. They use lots of big showy words and a lot of empty phrases. And he said, don't pray like that. Pray like this. And then he delivers what we know as the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and power and glory forever. It's something we recite every Sunday. It's something most of you probably have memorized. And the point of teaching them to pray this way was to pull them from that selfish narrative of God is the cosmic vending machine, God is the eternal genie granting wishes, and make them realize God doesn't love like that. But building upon last week's sermon, God loves us like a father. A parent. And God gives us what we need when we need it, and we can trust that. Now, it's not always going to be what we want when we want it. But through God's grace, He will provide us what we need when we need it. But it's hard sometimes, because kind of like me on a plane, there's a whole lot of smooth sailing. You get up at the cruising altitude in the plane, and it's a smooth ride. It's a lot smoother than some of the old cars I've had. And an old Geo Metro I've mentioned in a couple sermons. You know, I'm sure driving down on glass would feel like a gravel road. But there's some parts of flying that are very smooth, very calming, very relaxing. But then you hit that one little bump, and it makes you question the whole thing. Or you have that one shaky takeoff. As you turn into the wind, and you can see everything thrown around the cabin, and people's hats floating, and drinks spilling, and it makes you question the whole thing, and call the trust you had in the captain into doubt. Life is the same way for us with our relationship with God. We can say that we no longer see God as some eternal genie granting wishes for us, that we really see God as a loving Father who desires nothing but our needs and best interests. But that is the smooth sailing. That's the 35,000 feet when nothing's going wrong and there are clear skies and no wind. What happens then when we hit turbulence? what happens then on that shaky takeoff? Or if you have to land in a storm? What happens when those things in life shockingly upset the placid nature of our trust in God? What happens when our world is turned upside down? And we no longer know what is up and down, or left or right. This prayer something I think that the Catholics do so well, this prayer calls you back to the place of knowing God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. When we hit that turbulence, when we hit that bumpy road, we can in this life take hold of something like the prayer Christ has given us today and be reminded that our God is one whom we can trust completely. Oh, they might be bumpy. Oh, things might get spilled. It might be storming out in your life. But God will see you safely home. He calls us to remember that today. He calls us to remember that we might, as his people, trust him. And trust the plans he has for us. That throughout all of this journey of life, from beginning to end, we would remember and we would trust that our God really is in control. And our God, no matter the ups and downs and the bumps and the spills, really will see us home. He might not grant every desire we have, but he'll make sure we get to his kingdom in one piece. He'll make sure that we make it, regardless the weather. As flying home this weekend, and as I said, it was a bumpy takeoff, and I was put in a holding pad around Brownwood, the most exciting thing to look at in the air, and then diverted to Austin, where we sat on the ground for almost 2 hours. And then finally, hours later, after flying through one storm, landing in another in Austin, finally, hours later, I touched down in Dallas. Safe, sound, didn't even have to share a seat with anyone. It's great. My doubts, my anxiety, my fear erased. Said, made it home. Folks, wherever you are in life, wherever those doubts, anxieties, and fears about how God is leading you are creeping in, no matter if you are diverted in your life and it takes a turn you didn't expect, or whether you wind up in a place in life where you weren't anticipating, know that God will bring you safely home. It might be longer, it might be bumpy. But you can trust. You can trust that God will provide and he will bring you home. And you will come down safely one day in his kingdom. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.